History will remember Alex Ferguson as one of the great managers. A man who inspired fear and hatred, love and respect. A man who dared not lose. Last season, Alex Ferguson allowed us to make two films of his life. To see Manchester United through his eyes. To see his past through those that know him best.
What's this?
You were supposed to fill this in some time ago.
Statement of health. After Saturday's not too good. Your full name, Alexander Chapman Ferguson. Scottish.
I'm proud of it.
Proof. Birth date, 31/12/41. Weight.
You don't see the real Alex when he stood on the touchline or he's marching along before a game. You just see the man that's doing the job. You know, we see the real man.
Male. Height, 5 foot, 5 foot 10.
And 3/4.
High blood pressure, heart attack, angina pectoris, or any other disorder of the heart or blood vessels.
No.
No, but that's coming. The way that team of the mind's playing now. Infection of contagious disease. No, other than losing. Are you pregnant? No. 1998. That's it. Right.
And this is to Neil, another great manager.
Another great manager?
Yeah.
It's a lovely day tomorrow. Tomorrow is a lovely day. Just forget your troubles and learn to say, tomorrow is a lovely day.
Alex Ferguson came from Govan, a tough working class part of Glasgow. The only show-offs were at the annual Govan Fair.
People say in Govan, what's a well-balanced Scotsman, a chip on each shoulder, you know, and Govan's a classic, yeah. Govan, they were all sort of midgets, pretend they were 6 feet tall and etc. And last word experts, last word experts. No matter when you throw away, bang, wallop, he'll always come back with a retort.
Times were hard after the Second World War. There were shops, but who had money to spend in them? In Glasgow, families were crammed into the old tenement blocks. That was where the Fergusons lived.
Tomorrow is a lovely day. Come and feast your tear-dimmed eyes on tomorrow's clear blue sky.
The children that I dealt with, a lot of them were undernourished, underfed. They came from very, very poor families. They had to scrimp and they had to save. And there's cases of children going through dustbins and scavenging. Now, this did happen. It was repulsive and repugnant that that should happen in a civilised society.
Lots of homes had no baths. In fact, Alex's home had no bath.
We were fortunate we had an inside toilet and two rooms and a kitchen. And we actually lived directly above the pub. So our entertainment some Friday nights was when the pubs came out, there was an odd scrap. You get the window up and watch the fight, you know. So it was interesting. I think it was just, yeah, I had to survive. It was a matter of survival of the fittest. And you just had to survive.
You had to be competitive as a person. You were always having to push yourself. And parents were pushing the kids with a basic discipline. Get up in the morning. Get out and do this, etc. I mean, lying in the morning was just foreign. Forget about that.
We'd play cards, Alec and I. Alec used to cheat all the time. He'd tell you different. But he once had 5 pontoons in a row and he told me he wasn't cheating.
Last season, Manchester United reached the quarter-finals of the European Champions League, the biggest prize in club football. Manchester United hasn't won it since 1968.
Yes.
Alex Ferguson has never won it.
I think everyone in life has an apprehension about success, and I sometimes say to myself,
what's going to trip me up, because people can say, oh, you never won a European Cup, and you start looking for the demons again, you know what I mean? I keep reminding myself, I say, look, just let your players go on with it, trust them. They are good enough, they've got good ability. They know the guidelines, and they don't let me down. On odd occasion, they may just get a little bit exuberant, but nothing stupid. They know then if I catch them up to anything, then I'll not be happy. They represent themselves as a hero to a lot of young people, so we're very conscious of that, travelling abroad. It's important to us.
United have made smooth progress to reach the last eight, but preparations for the flight to Monaco are not going quite so well.
There have been occasions over the years that players have forgot their passports and things like that. David Beckham forgot his passport this time. I forgot it once myself, you know, and it's so embarrassing, you know.
You're supposed to win after him.
Won their championship last year, and they're in the quarterfinals of the European Cup, so they're not a terrible side by any means.
I suppose a lot has been made of the injuries.
Yeah, we'll go on, mate. There's no problem with that. They're good enough, and this is the moments which they all hope they get involved in. So we're ready. We think that I know my team, and hopefully we can do the business. Yeah. All right, bye bye.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and a special welcome to Mr. Alex Ferguson and the Manchester United Football Club. We'll be heading off to the southwest, passing over Stoke City, on our way past Wolverhampton Wanderers, West Bromwich Albion, and then passing between Oxford United and Reading.
The charter plane carrying the United party leaves a day earlier than normal. Ferguson wants to give the players a day off in the sun. On their arrival, they get news from home about an alleged fight between two Newcastle players, Alan Shearer and Keith Gillespie, whom Ferguson had sold.
Shearer and Gillespie had a fight.
Yeah, I saw that in Sky News.
That's good.
Yeah.
What the hell? What's happened to my former players?
No discipline, sir. They're too far away from you now. They're not under threat anymore.
Shearer banjured him, or
And that voice was called.
What?
An ambulance was called.
Yeah.
Tell you one thing. Gillespie's many things, but he's not a fighter. Shearer says he just slipped.
It's so weird.
Slipped right in my fist.
Slipped on her right boot.
You heard it too.
Nobody helped to hear it.
The players are well aware that if they need anything, if they're in trouble, any shape or form, they know they can knock on my door. They all know that, and they all do. In terms of the socialising, well, I just don't socialise with my players. I think that there has to be that demarcation line that say, well, your players, I'm the manager. And I'm comfortable with it, and they don't need to say, well, boss, would you like to go out with my wife and I for dinner? You know, and I know it's happened with some managers, and there's nothing wrong with that. But I just feel that it's better the players have their own social life and I have my own social life, and it's a far better relationship.
While Alex prepares his lads for the big match, his wife Cathy is back home in Cheshire.
I mean, I'm quite happy in the background. I mean, I would never want to be one that was in the limelight, you know. I think you need to have something staple, especially if you're bringing a family up, you know. Can't you all be superstars? Yes, I'll give it 8 out of 10. This is one I done earlier. Oh, that's nice. Put it out in the hall. Actually, when he's under your feet, it's a nuisance, you know. I mean, if he's here too long, you know, he gets in my road, you know. But I think you find that with most women, because you get into a routine, you know. I know that a lot of the people in Aberdeen at the main worked in the rigs, you know, for 2 weeks and 2 weeks. When they came back after 4 or 5 days, the women were screaming.
In Monte Carlo, people are serious about money. In Manchester, it's football. Some United supporters have arrived early for the team's training session.
Fortunately, the players are more or less ready for it. You know, and what we're doing is getting them used to the surface, and it's not a good surface, believe me. So it's important for them tonight to feel confident they can handle it.
That's it, get some rhythm.
Next.
Oh, careless.
And again, Nicky.
The other part which is really important is the observation. Sometimes you can spot little things that others don't see, and maybe little dip in form, and they're maybe worrying about something, and it manifests itself in the training session. You can see it, and one or two players are not playing as well as they can, then we watch them really closely in training and maybe have a chat with them.
Come and support them, boy. Run behind them. Good pass, good pass, David. Concentrate the pass. Oh, Bobby!
I always like to think I'm young in relation to understanding them and have a joke with them.
I was contempt at.
You have to have an environment where they're not, oh, here's the manager. And I think that helps me, you know. This is like comfy.
Well, if they wanted to laugh, they would be alright. Yeah, well, he can make you laugh. Sometimes he knows that he's making people laugh, sometimes he doesn't know. But, now and again, he'd come up with a little thing that players would find very funny, and he doesn't think that's funny. But basically, he's the kind of person that wants to have a lot of fun.
That's a that's out! Get it, Ben! Yes!
Who's that?
Alex played football for his school and did well in class. In another time, he might have gone to university. It wasn't an option then. The school was just a stone's throw from Ibrox Stadium, the home of Rangers.
He was a very normal, nice boy. Of course, he wasn't really interested particularly in schoolwork at that point. I mean, little girls are inclined to want to please the teachers, you know. Little boys really couldn't care less whether the teachers pleased or not, you know.
He loved his singing. He was a great guy for singing in the class. And the Will Ferguson, he'd be at the back of the class and he'd be going like this and, you know, rolling around in his seat. And at the end he'd say, "Sir, that was great."
I got on very well with the class. They knew I was getting married, and I think they just decided that they would come over and see the wedding. And I'm not quite sure how they found their way, but they did find their way to the church. The ushers, my friends were sort of, you know, a little doubtful about this shower of kids. However, Alec said, "It's our teacher." And in they went to the church, not going to be deterred, you know.
I heard there was a fight up at the football pitch. This guy had been picking on one of Alec's pals, and Alec, of course, took up the challenge. And when I got to it, it was the old story, a big crowd of guys, circle of schoolboys, and there was a fight in the middle of it, and I had to force my way through to get in to see what the situation was. Here was Alec boxing the living daylights out of this guy, and the guy must have been a few stones heavier and bigger and bulkier than Alec.
He had this other side to him where, you know, the body language, even at 11, 12, there was always the head forward, always the start a fight in an empty room, you know, which is, he's still got that same attitude.
If you were a Glasgow boy in the 50s, you played football in the street. There were no cars to get in the way. Games went on until it got dark or a policeman turned up. Get caught and you might end up in court. Glasgow was a divided city. You were defined by your team. Protestants supported Rangers, Catholics Celtic. but not in Alex's house.
His dad was a Protestant. Alex's father was a Protestant. And if you came for this neck of the woods, being a Protestant and supporting Celtic, but he didn't just support Celtic. It was very, very unusual that Mr. Ferguson was the chairman of Celtic Supporters Club in Neptune Street, right in the heart of Govan.
There was no sectarian singing and things like that, religious songs or anything like that in the club I run. It was a well-run club, well-organised club, and I never heard anybody castigating him because he was Protestant and supported Celtic.
When the two boys came to school, Alec wore the Rangers scarf and Martin wore the Celtic scarf. There was rivalry between the two of them, for obvious reasons. And a battle started. It happened quite a few times. Blood was spilt.
Both brothers would eventually play professional football. Alex would play for his heroes. Manchester United faced the French champions Monaco in the first leg of their European quarter-final. Their supporters are confident of victory. Alex Ferguson presents a relaxed image for the press.
The typecast is like some of the old B-movie actors, you know, that they're always going to be a sailor, they're always going to be a cowboy. And they typecast me as a dour, stubborn Scot. You know, it fits a sort of a role for me, if you know what I mean.
Right, my way.
Come on.
Not the same government.
None of them in government either.
He's from the same background, isn't he? He is a fan. He's a football fan. He's a football player. He lives for football. The things he comes out with, you know, he's speaking from the fan's mind rather than a manager's mind and some detached entity as part of the team.
He's just got to go out and win the lot. He's got to win the League Cup, the FA Cup, the League and the European Cup.
God, it's all the FA Cup.
Yeah, no, listen. Don't
do that. Try the cock of the law. We're the scouts, the cockies, of course.
And me.
We're all united, we're happy.
Usually, Monaco only play before a handful of supporters, but for tonight's occasion, the stadium is packed. The wealthy locals rattle their jewellery as the home team attack on the rock-hard pitch. United's aim is not to lose. A narrow win or even a draw would be a good result. Ferguson has told his players to be cautious, to curb their attacking instincts. It's a tactical battle and neither team is giving anything away.
Managers didn't play the part that they do now. In my time as a player, they never made a great tactical contribution. The players in the main did more talking. But the best coaches have got the best imagination. So it's an important part of the preparation to become a manager. Develop your imagination, you know. Because a lot of players, and it's happened quite regularly now, that they're a player one day and a manager the next without any preparation whatsoever. The only preparation that they've got is they actually played in the game they're going to be teaching. There is a definite thing about European football, and there is a bit of cunning involved in it, and a bit of caution. The cautious part is they're not going to lose a goal, but equally so, to add that little bit extra just to punish teams when they've attacked you.
game ends 0-0. United and their supporters can expect to win the tie back in Manchester.
My experience teaches me many things, and I've been in the stage before, 0-0 away from home, and it can be a long night at Old Trafford. But there are a lot of advantages for us, because the atmosphere will be absolutely electric, and they've got to handle that.
You're a runaround lover, though you say it isn't so. But if you put me down for another, I'll know, believe me, I'll know. 'Cause a night has a thousand eyes, and a thousand eyes can't help but see.
In the 60s, rock and roll hit Britain. Alex Ferguson and his pals hit Glasgow.
Alex, I remember once he was singing a song, Alex, a hopeless singer, tuneless, but loves music, I mean, loves music. And we sang Neil Sedaka numbers. Alex's song was I Go Ape. I go ape every time I see you. And I don't even know if Sedaka knows the words to it, but Alec always had a go at it and made his own words up.
There was two styles in those days. One was the sort of teddy boy image with a long jacket and the drainpipe trousers and the side boxers down to here. And the Mooney style was the shorter jacket, Crombie, it had to be a Crombie jacket. If you're really in the style, it was a Crombie jacket, and Alec had a Crombie jacket. And he had the winkle picker shoes and the pericomb hairstyle.
There was dancing on the Sunday. That was the business. Just fantastic. The girl sat at the other end and you sat at this end, looking good, and I think she fancies me. And the last dance, they always put the lights out, and they played Smoke Gets In Your Eyes. I mean, is there anything more romantic than dancing with some princess we govern, and they ask me how I knew. I mean, it's fantastic.
They ask me how I knew my true love was true.
I think I met Cathy in the Carnal, if I remember right. Two or three different girlfriends, and then Cathy came on the scene, and of course I thought, oh, it's just another girlfriend, you know, and wonder how long she'll last.
When I first saw him, he had got his nose broken playing football, and he had two big black eyes, you know, and I remember seeing him, and I says to my pal, if I look at him, he looks like a right badging, you know, because I didn't know he played football, you see. I just seen this guy walking about with, you know, and then she said, maybe he's a boxer.
I remember Alec, this is it. I mean, from being Jack the Lad and girlfriends here and there and starting to play football in Johnson Dunfermline, that was him. He was game, set and match. Cathy had just, he had found the girl of his dreams. He was getting married.
Just a small wedding. Martha Street Register Office. The reason was that was Alec was Protestant and I was Catholic, and nobody wanted to give, so we just had a quiet wedding, you know. In these days it was different, you know. I mean, there was a lot of... It's all changed now. Even both churches have changed. You know, Catholic Church is more lenient, you know. But then it was different. Especially in Glasgow.
Alec's family worked in the shipyards. He escaped, serving his apprenticeship as a toolmaker for Remington Rands, makers of typewriters and razors.
Only the Remington Roller-Matic has adjustable roller combs to give you the easiest clean shave.
Down for the tough bits and up for the old tender bits. Can't do better than that, can you? And it's quick. It's all over in a couple of minutes, isn't it? I mean, a good shave like that, and you're fresh for the old festivities, ain't you?
There's no doubt he was very popular. I remember one thing he did was throw a penny down and catch it on his toe. And then he'd throw it up in the air with his toe and catch it on his brow. Then he'd slide his coin down his nose and he'd drop it down and catch it on the other foot. That was a miracle to me.
Alex Ferguson completed his 5-year apprenticeship, but his future lay outside the factory gates. His future was in professional football. Manchester United are in the quarter-finals of the European Champions League. A win at home against Monaco will bring the club closer to the trophy it most covets. The trophy it last won under Matt Busby, 30 years ago. I know the reason why good boys.
You like my singing? Are we ready, Kenneth? There you are, then.
It's the biggest game of the season for Alex Ferguson. The day before the match, he meets the press.
There's going to be a lot of press there, and they're going to be assessing me how I look and how I handle it and what I'm going to say and what the vibes are going to, and their own opinions are going to be down in writing. And of course, you know what that could mean. It could mean a large variation in assessment of my interview, you know what I mean? It's very variable.
How do you ever envisage this match unfolding tomorrow? Will it be the same patience needed?
It's not an easy game, but then at this stage of the Cup, you don't expect an easy match. And a lot of people, and there's a lot of vibes coming from their camp, which are very positive. Well, it'll be a very hard game for them too tomorrow. So.
Just a word about Remo van der Gaal, he's come in. I mean, he doesn't get many opportunities because of the presence of Schmeichel. I mean,
well, he came in the semi-final last year. I don't, in any way, shape or form, have any reservations about it at all. There's no question about that.
Alex is very good and he prepares himself for meeting the media. And it's not quite an act, but it is certainly a scripted performance by him, that he knows exactly what he wants to say, so he gets the best performance out of his players. He uses the psychological tricks of that. And obviously use it to pass on disinformation to the rival camp too.
We trained Giggs this morning and he's coming back this afternoon. He did okay. Did quite well actually, but Johnson, Philip Neville all remain doubtful.
Do you think the fact it can end up being a positive thing in the way your boys hopefully will respond to it all tomorrow?
Well, I think they will respond to it. They'll respond to the challenge for a start. They'll be nervous, what you expect of any young players, but they're going to get great help from the fans and from the players round about them and from me.
Send your programme notes, Alex, on Saturday, just about the importance of the crowd in the big games. That's going to be vital tomorrow night, isn't it? That you have another great European night here.
I'm just looking at that tie, Steve.
Isn't it?
Anyway, tomorrow night, they know themselves. They won't let us down tomorrow night.
Have you thought of dressing your players in those ties tomorrow? Might they strike Monaco?
It's always difficult to judge what kind of mood is in anyway, because you know, you can be smiling 1 second and then. And then, you know, you can get the biggest rollicking of your life the next. But, you know, that's the man. I mean, and if you live and work in a jungle, I mean, you've got to be frightened of the wild.
That's one great quality we have. The resilience and the determination of the players is wonderful. And we'll need to be tomorrow.
It is very much a zone of aggravation for him. He knows it is a duty, as he's in charge of a massive club, to deal with the press and the media. But, I mean, given the choice, I don't think he would be sort of over-welcoming.
Ken, is that all right?
Yes, great, thank you.
I don't think there's a lot you can do. What you can do is you can ignore it and do your job as best you can. Don't read the papers, particularly after you lose a game. There's no point to it. And I took that advice to somebody, and I think it's good advice. And then I passed it on to a lot of people, and
And even my players, I says, why read it? And I hear them all in the dressing room going on about, but that's writing this and what, and that writing that, you know. I said, why do you read it? There's no point to it. I can't do you any good.
There we are. That was the store.
Alex Ferguson made his name as a striker in Scotland. He was tough and uncompromising, the kind of player you'd rather have on your side.
He was very difficult as an opponent, not because of his ability, but because of the way he played. He played with his elbows out, and we used to always say that he wore his boots under his elbows. He probably could have controlled the ball better with his elbows.
He played football as he plays life, really, always to win. Alex Ferguson would steamroller anybody if he could. Winning at anything is his objective.
His prolific goal scoring for St Johnstone, then Dunfermline, earned him a call-up for a Scottish tour. His performance in Australia led to the biggest move of Alex's career.
Highlighting the clash of fierce battles for possession, which frequently earns the displeasure of South Australian referee Bill Hosey. Playing with the wind, the visitors penetrate through well-timed passing and skillful ball control. Ferguson shot his home, giving the tourists a half-time lead of 1-0.
I had the story exclusively from my paper, The Daily Record. George Farm was the manager, and he telephoned me the day before, and he said, if you happen to be at Ibrox tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock, you'll see somebody walking up to me. You'll know who it is, and he's going to sign for Rangers.
We were delighted, because we knew we had a problem in that position. And at that particular time, Alec was probably the best player in Scotland in that position. And the bottom line as well was, I'm living just 200-300 yards down the road here. He was very much Rangers orientated, so his heart was here.
The big issue with it is how many goals was he going to score? Because he'd been very successful against Rangers and against Celtic. So for that point of view, I really believe the platform was there for him.
Ferguson! Ferguson,
close to the line. Henderson. Well, Ferguson certainly lived that one.
Alex Ferguson was Rangers' top scorer in his first season. A great season for him, but not for the club. They lost only one game, and that was enough to give Celtic the title. During the season, Rangers had changed manager. David White came in, and Alex was on his way out.
He didn't go in with a new manager. And the manager decided to take his own way of doing things with Alec. And in fact, he left him out of the training, and he would be kicking a ball about on his own.
As a boy, Alex Ferguson had dreamt of playing for Rangers. Now it had turned into a nightmare. But he got one last chance, a cup final against Celtic, the fiercest derby of them all.
Well, the fans didn't actually use guns or anything desperate like that, but it really was a sort of trigger point. I mean, the atmosphere, you could cut it with a knife. There was hatred dropping like ice blocks on top of you, you know.
Well, there's two people suffered from that game, and one was the goalkeeper, and one was Alec. Alec never played again for Rangers after that. He got the blame of the first goal.
When the ball came across, I couldn't believe it. I was on my own, and I could see a big space at the near post.
And McNeil was actually going to be being marked by Alec Ferguson.
I always remember saying to myself, how in the name of hell did I get so free?
I
Billy was looking back, he would probably say it was the most important header he had. And it's probably the moment that Alex Ferguson would least like to remember.
It was one of the easiest goals I ever scored.
From their clearance, Celtic mounted a counter-move in no-nonsense style, which swept down the left wing and won them an all-important corner. There'd been less than 2 minutes of play when Old put the ball across for McNeil to head it home. Sensation!
From my thinking, to blame a centre-forward for losing a goal, can he be entirely right? But if it was his fault, then thanks very much, Fergie.
I was a defender, so it couldn't have possibly been my fault. So I'll have to put the blame on him.
I thought it was just my brilliance that created the goal rather than anybody else's fault.
I don't wish to be biased, but I think it was his fault for the other three goals as well.
A minute to the interval, Bobby Lennox scored the second. There was barely time for Martin to recover before he was beaten by the third goal. When Chalmers scored Celtic's fourth goal, all hell broke loose.
Conveniently, Rangers and a lot of the fans found a ready-made scapegoat. Although there was four goals scored that day, they found poor old Alex Ferguson, the man that they could blame most of all for this terrible drubbing.
I know it was sad because I know he took it really badly. In fact, I think I don't think he's got his loser's medal. I think he threw it away after the game.
An outcast amongst his own, it seemed life couldn't get any worse for Alex Ferguson. But it did. On a tour of Denmark, his teammates discovered him out of control.
One of the players, myself, walked into the hotel, and there was the bold Alex, and he was drunk, shouting and bawling, top of his voice, in the middle of the foyer of the hotel. And that was unusual for him, because he was quietish in those days. But he was wearing his pyjamas, and they were bright red pyjamas, and he was shouting and bawling, and everybody in the place was looking at him. So I went across and I says to him, what's wrong? And apparently he'd phoned Cath that morning, and in the Daily Express there was a statement from this club saying that he would never play for Rangers again. He was really, really upset that nobody had even spoken to him about it. So I really felt sorry for the way he was treated here.
I think the writing was on the wall before that. I think there was a lot of politics going on at Ibrox at that time. Because there's nobody worked harder for Rangers than Alex. Nobody gave more to Rangers than Alex did in terms of graft and working and fighting for the team.
My heart is broken, but what care I? Such pride inside me has broken. I'll try my best not to cry by and by when the final farewells must be spoken. I'll join the Legion, that's what I'll do. And in some
reason... 7:30 in the morning, Alex Ferguson is one of the first to arrive at the Cliff, Manchester United's training ground. Tension is rising for the quarter-final against Monaco. It's a game they must win.
My heart is broken, what can I say?
Coming to the Cliff in the morning is good motivation for me, really, because I know the players are going to come in, I know my staff are going to come in, I know that I'm in an environment where there's a bit of banter and there's a bit of life about it. And it's a football environment.
Okay. Right, you might do me now. Go on in. Right,
go on. 1-2-3-4, 1-2-3-4, 1-2-3-4. When you went over to Monaco 2 weeks ago, did you actually learn anything new about that side?
Yeah, the pitch is worse than I thought. No, I think that they're a determined team. There's no question about that. They defend very well. My main concentration will be on producing a team that possibly get into the semi-final. Hello. Yeah. We're running out of games in our hockey. But if you want to leave it to the beginning next season, that's absolutely no problem. I can do that. All the games are sold out this season anyway. Give me a phone at the start of the season, hockey, and you look after yourself. Take care. All best. Thanks a lot.
Bye.
One more question. 20 years.
Sorry?
Haven't heard from him for 20 years. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4.
We got a message for the fans, Alex?
Well, they know the importance. I thought they were, you know, and Saturday it seemed quiet and normal. But then I think Saturday sometimes Old Trafford, I think the Wednesday night games are far better. I think all the real supporters are there. I think on Saturdays you get a lot of people travelling from abroad and commercial packages and things like that. And it's not the same United fans. But on a Wednesday night, Old Trafford, quarter final European Cup, then they'd be magnificent.
Thanks.
All right.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, well.
United have an injury crisis. Ferguson is looking for anything that might tip the balance back in his favour. He starts with the state of the pitch.
Right, the pitch. I don't care how much water you put in it, the fucking thing, right? You just get every bit of water you can. What is it? What is the forecast? I'll get it fucking flooded. All the time. It maybe not suit us perfectly. Pardon? No. No. What the... Hey. I've watched the videos about 12 times. The information we give to the players now is going to be definite, you know? That they're clear exactly how they're going to operate. And there is definitely a pattern to how they've approached their away games. Quite positive away from home. I've got all the games. I could pick a team.
Right, can we go on to the script now?
Yeah.
Right, so the menu requires a voiceover.
Yeah.
Headlines flying in and gradually obliterating his face. With the soundtrack of Psycho. So.
Oh. 7 million people will watch the match on television. A big money spinner that demands a big build-up.
Sort of tension and, you know, this sort of slightly beleaguered feeling which is definitely around the place. And that's all they've got to go
for. A big night tonight for United, and now they concentrate for a couple of weeks on the Premiership, or disastrous night for United. What's left now, focusing on...
Yeah, you can use that either way.
Winning the Premiership, the double's back on.
I would have to say I think the goalkeeper's far more important tonight, really.
No.
The news from the treatment room is bad. Gary Pallister and Peter Schmeichel never had a chance of playing. Ryan Giggs would have needed a miracle. All three will be missed.
He's very good that way with the term of the injury. I can't think of the 4 years where he sort of, oh, look, you know, you must play him or you must tell him you must play. You know, he's pretty good that way. Like most managers, you know, coaches I've worked for in other sports, you know, they'd have ups and downs, really. But I mean, I think at the end of the day, if you take them out of the pitch, show them what they can do, and talk to the players, explain to them what's wrong with them. I mean, it's a cutthroat business, really. I mean, players, once they've got the shirt, they don't want to lose it. And if somebody's misfortune of being injured, it means it gives somebody else a possibility of getting into the team. So you just got to go in and explain the situation to him. And all right, sometimes he's not happy about it, but it's part of my job. I mean, he knows you're not doing it on purpose. You just got to be there to do it.
It's frustrating when you miss big important games, because that's, you know, they're the best nights of your life. Winning cup finals or playing big nights in Europe, you know, I mean, you're never going to get them back. So, I mean, you've got to find it within yourself as well. I mean, you know yourself whether you're going to be fit enough to play or whether you can maybe get away with playing.
Here I saw your letter.
At the end of the day, I think once I get my 11 players set in my own mind what it's going to be, and I don't know at this moment in time, in the afternoon we've got them in for massages and they'll all be available for selection. The ones who have gone in for the massages, I will be able to pick a team I believe will win. There's no question in my mind about that. The players are not available to me, they don't exist. give them the hardest day of their life.
Yeah, absolutely.
If they're going to run, they're going to have to run through a bit of softness. Yeah. We'll test their endurance to the limit.
The boss is the shrewdest manager I've ever known, to be honest, and he takes everything into account. I mean, he'd suss that Monaco play on a car park and that they might not be used to soft pitches. And if we can just get an advantage by making the ball slicker across the surface, that's not cheating, that's playing to your advantage.
Hi, Bob.
Turf or otherwise? You sit down.
3 hours before kick-off, Ferguson meets the television producers to talk through his team.
Thanks, Galway.
I had a
sabre
on top,
see. Not too bad, as long as they don't drop dead in me. Mm. They're loving the pick, you know what I mean? If that stays in the pitch, you have a chance. Mm.
So there's obviously a couple that are not 100%.
So I'm starting with Phil Neville right back.
Van der Haring goal, presumably.
Van der Haring, yeah. Gary Neville.
So Phil Neville at right back?
Yeah, yeah. Gary Neville centre back. Yeah. With Ronnie Johnson. Midfielder Scholes. But Beckham.
Yeah.
Yeah. Up front of school, Solskjaer, Sheringham Cole, and I'll place Solskjaer towards the left.
So basically you decided, Alec, you couldn't take a risk on Giggsy?
One of the reasons I was very positive about Giggs was I wanted him to think he was definitely playing. Yes. Mm. I knew there was a doubt, but I had to be very positive about it because I brought in another defender.
But we won't put that out, obviously, until,
okay.
until no, no, no. 5 minutes before we...
I've got your team. I expect to be celebrating tonight because I know the players will do everything they possibly can to win the match. And when you boil it all down, we're asking Manchester United players to win one game at Old Trafford in a season. Just one game of football. 0-0, starting from scratch at Old Trafford, 55,000. That history is waiting for us. We're waiting for our players to add themselves to the history of this club. And they'll know when they don't.
Supporters are still taking their seats when disaster strikes. Monaco score. Now United must score twice. They look tired and beaten.
I could put 11 tremendous players out in the European tie and I would never get near winning another football match. Never. In Europe, you need more than just ability. You need more than the organisation. Most English teams are well organised as a 4-4-2. It's when they come up against a situation they're not used to, they don't change. And you need players who can adapt quickly in a game of football. They can change. So
an equaliser for United brings hope, but no salvation. Chance is gone for another year. Another year for the supporters, another year for the players, and another year for the manager.
At the end of the day, that you hope young players pick it up and next year they're young enough to go again. But why suffer Schmeichel and Palace, maybe that's a disappointment and maybe not for them. You know, you never know. Under the circumstances, definitely, I'm sure I picked the right team.
I hoped it'd be playing Solskjaer, Sheringham and Cole, that one would score a goal, and one of them did. The key to it was not always a goal, and of course we let ourselves down with that because it's such a sloppy goal to us. And after 5 minutes, you know, it killed us. Anyway.
Alex, after such a magnificent first 4 or 5 months, we cut off a bit of the knees, don't you, by circumstances?
Almost shattered.
I don't want you to be shattered.
It's a good one, that, wasn't it?
But I wonder if you could put into words, obviously, it's a massive climate.
No, listen, you've seen it before, but you go through peers and his management, you have to take that. We could take that here, right?
And you just have to take it, New Park quoting. I thought we would have won the game, going with our strongest team.
Emerge from his own season in the shadows.
But the real...
To plunder...
Sorry, but the early goal.
A 53rd minute in equaliser.
But in the end, the United couldn't climb the final mountain of their dreams.
Manchester United are riding high. The next game is against Liverpool. They need to win if they are to keep their lead at the top of the Premiership. Ferguson prepares for the challenge.
A manager searches for motivation because he knows how to search for it. I mean, I know where to search for my motivation. And I think doing a bit in the gymnasium is good for me.
Squeeze the area! Squeeze the area, Nicky! Squeeze the answer, Ryan! That's not a place to be, men!
The thing about motivation is it's a very much spur of a moment thing that you use as a key. In most cases, a cause is the best form of motivation. Religion, your country, Manchester United against the world. We use it, I use it from time to time.
That's a good corner, that. Give him an angle, give him an angle. Oh, across Pally, across Pally.
The team mirrors its manager because they reflect a lot of what you are in your life and what you believe in. And that is a very important job, a role for the manager, to create that type of identity.
At the age of 32, Alex Ferguson became a manager. He went to St Mirren in Paisley, a town living in the shadow of Glasgow.
Paisley is a big town in Scotland, and it didn't have the following at Love Street that it should have had. So the bold Fergie got into an open car, stood up in the seat and went round the street shouting and telling people they better get to Love Street on Saturday to see the best match of the whole Scottish card. He did this regularly.
I mean, he was on the go all the time and worked up, and, you know, I mean, if when he wanted to run before he could walk, sort of a style, you know, if everything didn't go right, you know.
Well, we certainly shared the same ambition for St Mirren for possibly different reasons. Being a supporter, I wanted the best for the club, and Alec wanted the best for the club to help his own ambitions, obviously.
As a player, Ferguson had been hungry for success. He didn't get it. As a manager, it would be different. St Mirren were promoted. It made Paisley proud.
Start. Unbelievable. Unbelievable.
That was his team. And they were his boys. And he was a manager.
And it didn't mean anything to me, whoever they were. They were his. They were Fergie's original fledglings.
There was certain games, right enough, he would say it at half-time as we're going out. I'll tell you now, if yous are beat, don't come in that dressing room. Don't come near here, so there was no way you're going to get beat and face Fergie.
Fergie, being Fergie, was sort of demanding in every area of the club, and he seemed to be, to some extent, taking it over, which he was, but greatly to the benefit of the club. And some of them didn't like that, and I think that was one of the things that caused his exit. But it was just bonkers.
After 4 years at St Mirren, Ferguson was sacked. A successful team, booming crowds were not enough. Heated words in the boardroom, arguments over expenses, were.
The chairman got a wee bit carried away with himself. And Alex being Alex, being maybe a bit naive, possibly, but certainly didn't want any interference. And it's history now.
I'm not going to go into any details about it. It's water under the bridge as far as I'm concerned, and it was a bad time for us all, and I'm quite sure I certainly regret it, and I'm quite sure Alec wishes it hadn't happened either.
The worst thing that's ever happened to St Mirren Football Club is Alec Ferguson leaving the club. To be honest, I think it's been devastating to the whole of Paisley as well.
Alex Ferguson learnt his lesson at St Mirren and would never look back. Paisley just watched him disappear into the distance. Manchester United play Liverpool tomorrow. Their captain is Paul Ince, a man who liked to call himself the governor when he was with United. It's a match where passions run high. Reds versus Reds. Everything must be right. No room for error.
I think my greatest fear is forgetting the boots. I think that's my greatest fear. I mean, the Middlesbrough kit man forgot the boots. A lot of people were taking the mickey out of him. I felt sorry for him. I wouldn't have wished that on anybody.
Right, OK. Well, let's just start in. The straightforward, as far as I'm concerned, you look after McManaman, close him down quickly. You don't need to detail a player. It's whoever's nearest, go and close him down, play against him. And don't allow them to then dictate the areas in which they play.
We've heard it every time we played Liverpool, McManaman's doing this. We know that. He doesn't really have to tell us, because we know. I think he likes team talks. I think he likes to talk to us.
I want you to go back 3 years ago, how we lost the league. We lost the league at Anfield by not listening to that instruction about McManaman.
It's the players, the problem. You're quite happy not to change. And when I first came to the club, I said to the players, I'm not going to change, by the way. There's no question about that. You will need to change, or they won't be there. And that's what happens, you see. The manager has to make his impact.
And they're given Ince the license just to go and attack without any defensive duties. But if he tries to bully you, fucking enjoy it. Don't let him attempt to bully you. Right? You just make sure you're ready for him tomorrow. And that's all you need to worry about him. It's fucking big time, Charlie, but it's against fucking men, am I right? And that's all you need to worry about him. Is he going to do Redknapp? That is a problem for them, by the way. We get the ball transferred into these areas here. I don't think they have a chance against us. I don't think they have a chance what yous have got. Any questions? You happy with that? All right? Right, okay, let's go.
I mean, he's probably thinking, you know, I have to get these players to listen to me on this tactical side of the game, because it can help you, and it's little things like that during a game that do help you. And like I said, I just hope that we are listening.
There we are.
The gaffer. Oh, he set me up a kipper in Monaco. Came in and said, I've just seen some kids running out with all the boots, and he looks at me and I looked at him, and the next minute I was off after these kids, gets down the steps, and there's a big gate, and I nearly vaulted over the gate, and I looked round and everybody was laughing at me. The gaffer had set him up, he put him round the corner, so he's one up at the moment, but I've got to get him back.
That's fun.
Alex Ferguson told Aberdeen they could be the top club in Scotland. Nobody really believed him. He told his young lads they could be the best team in Scotland. They believed him. They were too scared not to.
Fines, and obviously his very aggressive govern manner, intimidated the kids quite a lot. And on occasion, him and Archie would produce this baseball bat and torment the young boys with that. But it was all good-hearted fun.
Very scary. I think a lot of us were in awe about when he was around, you know. He had this sort of fear factor. You just never knew when he'd pop up.
Oh, he was laughing a minute. He was great for the club, Neil Cooper, and I think he was a great foil for Alec Ferguson as well. He used to wind the Cooper boy up, but he got his revenge, he started winding Fergie up.
At the time, there was a full-size snooker table in the multi-gym, and I said to Ian Angus, who doesn't do anything wrong, I'm sure he's the nicest boy you could meet, you know, I said, come on, we'll have a game of snooker. He said, no, but Fergie's still in the building. And I said, well, we'll be all right. I said, you know, Fergie's got the nervous cough. I says, I said, we'll hear him coming down the corridor. And when he comes down the corridor, we'll both jump on the multi-gym and start doing exercises. So the game was going along fine, you know, and I took a shot and jumped in the bench press. And Ian Angus was at the furthest away part from the multi-gym, just the way to strike the ball. And all of a sudden his head appears through the door. And it's Fergie, you know. He says, what the bloody hell's going on in here? And all of a sudden I heard this voice, so I start pushing up the weight, you know, and Ian Angus is standing at the furthest away part of the room holding this snooker cue. And he's standing there, all of a sudden he starts bending his legs and that. He says, what are you doing, Angus? He says, knee balancing, boss. Exercising my knee. He says, look at Cooper, that's an example for you. Well done, Sean. Keep up the good work. Angus, I'll see you later on.
The Scottish press is based in Glasgow. Ferguson told his players they were biased.
If I went up to Aberdeen and I said something critical about the players, he would wait till I was coming back, and he knew I was coming back, and he'd storm into the dressing room and say, that so-and-so Cameron is back here today now. You know what he said about you the last time? Get out there and show him. That's the West of Scotland press guy. Show them how well you can play.
He does have Man United now. That's it. Everybody hates us. The press don't want to come to Aberdeen to see you playing top games. They don't like you because they come for Glasgow. They think there's a superior appeal. And we bought it. I fell for it, and there used to be like 11 Tasmanian devils on about there.
To win in Scotland, Alex Ferguson had to beat the old firm, Celtic and Rangers, the Glasgow Giants. He used everything to convince his players they could go there and win. He told them everyone was against them, the referees, the press, the league. He made them angry. He made them win. In 1980, Aberdeen and Celtic were fighting for the championship. Ferguson went to Celtic twice and beat them. Twice.
Alex's aspect of this bias and always in the press about the bias that his team experienced against the old firm, that unsettled your players and annoyed them and maybe disturbed their concentration, and which it undoubtedly it did at times.
Aberdeen had definitely won the championship. Can you blame the man for going out of his mind temporarily?
Aberdeen won the title, the first club outside the old firm to win the league since 1965. Champagne was a rare taste for Aberdeen players, but they would get used to it. This was just the beginning. Ferguson demanded from his players what he demanded from himself. Everything. Their whole lives would be devoted to the cause.
You used to come round your house on a Friday night, you see this car sneaking by on a Friday night, seeing if you were in. What a sad man on a Friday night sneaking about in his car to see if I was in.
When Alec, the manager, was about, you know, you wouldn't even dream of drinking. I don't know what happened. I mean, to this day, someone passed me a drink. Someone shouted it was a Bacardi and Coke. 5-10 seconds afterwards, he seemed to jump out behind from a pillar, you know, and sort of jest, he said, "What's that you're drinking, Cooper?" You know, and I said, "Oh, you know," started going, "Can't I sweat on?" And I said, "It's Coke." And he came really quite close to me, you know, and he took my drink and he smelt it, and he just looked at me and he said, "That doesn't smell like bloody Coke to me." I says, it is Coke, you know. He says, and he tasted it. And he looked at me, he come closer, and he just said, "You're dead." He said, "You're dead." I says, "What?" He says, "You're dead." He says, "Monday morning," quietly he said it, "I'm going to run the bloody bollocks off you." He says, "You won't know what's hit you."
The league, now the cup. If you supported Aberdeen, life just got better and better. In 1983, it got stupid. Aberdeen reached the European Cup Winners' Cup final in Gothenburg. They would play Real Madrid. It was ridiculous.
There was a lot of people in Aberdeen never get a holiday that year, women, because all the men were saving up to go to Gothenburg. So you could hear them in shops going, "I'm getting a holiday this year because he's going to this match," you know. So, and they were taking kids with them. So it was really exciting because the whole city was buzzing.
Had a meeting, they said, "I know you've all got young kids, you've got young families." They said, myself in my situation, I'm only getting to know my kids now. They said, there's many, many years where I should have been maybe in the house, and I left it all for Cathy to do, and really, I missed a lot of my kids when they were growing up. They said, "I'd like some of you to do the same when we've got this big European game. Shut them out and concentrate totally on Aberdeen Football Club."
It was a once-in-a-lifetime experience. 14,000 supporters overran Gothenburg. The team overran Real Madrid. After just 7 minutes of the match, the unthinkable happened. Aberdeen scored. Real Madrid equalised from the penalty spot, and the game went into extra time. Madrid had settled for a penalty shootout. Aberdeen hadn't.
It's the greatest moment of my life. But I'll tell you, it's a magnificent performance. With the conditions, I thought we thoroughly deserved it. They're the ones that did it. The players out there.
They made him such a proud man that night. I mean, we were ecstatic. I mean, we were jumping over each other, and he didn't know where to go. You know, he didn't know who to jump on. And he would come and he would thank us and praise us, you know, and he was just ecstatic.
I don't know how Alec felt, but I know how I felt. He must have felt 10 times better than me. And I always remember I shouted up around the drinks. I got a fright of my life, and the boy, it was equivalent to £27 for a round of, I think it was 6 beers or something like that. And it wasn't pints, like, it was just small glasses of beer. It was something like £27. That was a lot of money to me, 1983. That was a hell of a lot of money to me. But nobody else bought a drink after it, funny enough. Typical Scots.
I'm telling you, I thought I had to keep her away from me.
I'm away.
Still
waiting my check.
I need to go, folks. I mean,
fine.
The minister says to me, would I like to go to the game?
Why don't you come?
Why don't you come? It's an afterthought.
Well, come to the game. Get a taxi.
Can't be bothered.
Need where?
I Mike Dillon and I are going out to the Hilton after it.
I
will.
I might be tempted. See you later. United are having a poor run of form. Arsenal are catching them up at the top of the Premiership. Nothing less than a win against Liverpool will do.
When we're not doing as well, I tend to focus on how lucky they are. Some people have to go out in the bells of the bloody air to earn up the next shilling. You can't see what's round about you down the pits of the air. But you have to go and work on some of these ships on the quiet side. You put rags around your arms to keep yourself warm. And so you're lucky.
He does come across with things like that. It is a good motivation because, you know, if he was in their boots working 8-10 hours a day in a factory, we want United to be doing well. My two brothers are the same. You know, they work 10-12 hour shifts. When I say to them, you know, I've got training tomorrow and it's peeing it down and all that, you know, they say, God, it's all right for you. I said, I won't mind working for an hour and a half, 2 hours in the rain. Try working, you know, 50-60 hours a week. That's work.
I don't think that it gets lost in them when I philosophy about life. I don't think it's lost in them. I think they do pay attention to that part. I think they need that. They need that to divert away from the pressure of the actual game.
United 1-0 up, but then Michael Owen scores for Liverpool. A goal that will cost United the title. The game is played at a frenzied pace, and just before half-time, Owen loses his head and is sent off. Liverpool down to 10 men, 45 minutes to go. It's a confident half-time team talk.
Now listen, just make sure, keep the tempo going. The other thing is, some of the passing is fucking scratchy. Get the passing fluid. Good touch in the ball. You don't always need it to pass it first time. You tried it in the once it took you 15, 20 minutes and you lost it. Take a touch in the ball. Now I look at that and they're playing a back four. There's the places to play.
Most managers can earn their money just in a half-time team talk alone because of it changes the state of play and you then can go on to win a match. And we've done it many times at Old Trafford. It's an important time, that half-time. Preparing what you think should be said.
Right now, get yourself sorted, okay? Come on. No easing up, come on now. Listen, don't let yourselves down here now. Don't even fucking attempt it.
The match finishes 1-1. It feels like a defeat.
Do we need it?
Yeah, the way you're talking, you think we're bottom of the league. We're fighting a relegation bomb. We're going for the championship here.
No, I'm
we're top of the league. We shouldn't be. We're too hard to please. We're too used to success at the moment.
Just a minute, make the point.
You know, in Europe.
Cancelled resigning and wanted to go and be an actor, which is fair enough, but he was never really replaced. Now, Sheringham was supposed to be the replacement, and he's over 30. He's not the replacement. Fergie's always said that if he wants a player, he's got a budget there, and he can get the money and he can go and sign whoever he wants. So
when we thrash Juventus, they were all on about everybody's good, all the kids good, we've got like Curtis Stanley coming through. No, there was no mention of buying big players then, was there?
Well, we didn't need them because United were playing well.
We should have been going out and buying players like Salas. This boy Salas, we should have burst the bank to get this boy here. He would have done it for us.
He wouldn't have replaced Cancer.
So worst season ever for injuries.
The club directors have a monthly board meeting. Alex Ferguson is invited to attend in his capacity as manager.
Can I sign the minutes of the 27th? I have had those already. And can we approve the minutes of the 10th of March? On the contract side, good news, Ryan Giggs has signed a new 5-year agreement.
And Paul Scholes is convening this afternoon to sign a 7-year agreement. Yeah.
It's a question of management, and I think sometimes clubs come in for criticism because the supporters will want you to buy anybody. They don't care if it's three times the wages of your existing stars. But in the longer term, that will actually destroy what you've tried to build up. But somebody has to be judge and master, and sometimes has to make those unpopular decisions. And it is a business, and the manager is an employee of the company.
No question about that. You're an employee, just like all the rest of them. But also, the chairman has to recognise your position too. I think that the record's there to be examined. We don't go willy-nilly for players that are just going to be piled up in the stock room. They're there because we need them.
People are not available for. So if you turn to page 2...
Alex Ferguson, don't be fooled, he is an astute businessman, I mean, very aware. He's equally focused on the job that he has to perform. And there are times where he will fight his corner and dig his heels in for something that he thinks he has to have to achieve his part of the business.
But who's refused?
Teddy Sheringham, the two Nevilles, Casper, David Beckham.
Have they gone in that space thing?
Yeah, I think so. Mm.
Well, of course, the only time we have to negotiate with Alec is on his personal contract. I think he knows his value.
It's a difficult one, you know, because you see all this money they're making, you know, and it's never reflected in the manager, you know, in the way it should be. Whereas you see other forms of business and their chief executives are recognised far more fully. But that's only... a thing that you say to yourself, well, I don't think it'll change in football that in that respect. You can be successful, but not too successful, you know what I mean, you know? The hottest thing
in the world. Manchester United were desperate. A great club whose glory days were far behind them. Ferguson had spent his last season managing Aberdeen and Scotland, but nothing compared to running United. Gordon Strachan was already there when his old boss arrived.
The 4th of November, half past 10 it was, when he arrived in Manchester. He said that he'd only leave Aberdeen for Barcelona and Manchester United. I kept praying the Barcelona coach would get the sack, to be honest with you. There you go.
How do you feel now you've got down here?
I'm not feeling comfortable now, I must admit. It's bad me as all get to the road.
They're giving you a good welcome, though.
Oh, great.
You're looking forward to the rest of the season?
Yeah.
I mean, it was exciting for the boys coming down to a big club like this, you know. But I must admit, I wasn't happy. You know, it took me a wee while to settle in. But there's no way he was going to turn that job like that. I wouldn't expect him to, you know. But, I was quite settled in Aberdeen, you know.
Cathy stayed back in Aberdeen while Alex made the move to Manchester. Instead of his wife, he moved down with his assistant manager, Archie Knox.
We lived in a semi-detached house in Timperley, it was. He, he chose the bigger room. You know, he left me in a wee box room, and it was always an agreement on a Sunday morning that one made the breakfast and one went for the Sunday papers. So I'm sitting reading the paper this morning and there was this almighty explosion in the kitchen. And I thought, what the hell's he done? I mean, he didn't have a clue how to put it on the oven or whatever. So I'd gone through and of course he's going like this. He's sort of saying, what was that? And there's smoke coming from everywhere. And I thought we'd try and do the two of us in that day.
Alex Ferguson was used to success. Now he tasted defeat. He made dramatic changes to the team, to the club. But after 3 seasons, he had nothing to show for it. He needed more time. That was the last thing he had. The hottest thing
in the world. 1989 is certainly the worst year of football I've seen at United. They were poor, they were not worth watching, and the crowds, I think, reflected that. You know, I think there was a lot of people called for his head, you know, in the autumn of 89.
I took a bed sheet off the bed
A light blue bedsheet for some reason, don't know why, black paint, and basically expressed my feelings in the banner, which said, 3 years of excuses and it's still crap. Ta-ra, Fergie.
The banner was raised to cheers at Old Trafford. The Fergie out bandwagon was running. People criticised his signings, criticised his sales. They said he was out of his depth. His darkest hour came at Main Road, the derby match against Manchester City. By the end of it, Ferguson said he felt like a criminal.
And the match, the derby, a new occasion too for the new United chairman, Michael Knighton, taking his seat in the hot seat at last.
And there we all are, very much full of anticipation, full of Derby Day fever. But everyone was absolutely mortified by the level of performance. It was a poor performance.
Old Firm 1-0. City in front. Gary Pallister should have cut it out. His long leg couldn't reach it. And Old Firm took advantage.
We just signed Gary Pallister to stabilise the defence. And Gary Pallister had a particularly bad game.
Super save by Leighton. Late maybe. United all over the place.
At half-time we were 3-0 down, everyone was shell-shocked, everyone was throwing beer over at City fans and vice versa. 3-1, Hughes gives a bit of hope, maybe, but not really. 5-1, as soon as the fifth goal went in, straight down the steps of the Kippack Street, straight out, and I walked all the way back to Old Trafford.
Just marvellous stuff!
I didn't know the result, and Dan came in here first, and it was at 5-0, and he went 5-0, and I went, that's brilliant, and he went... for Manchester City, and I should have known my dad's face, you know. And I went, and he went, well, you see my dad, you know. So
the press knew when to take their cue. It was no longer a question of whether Ferguson would get the sack, but when.
It was a common theme that if United would have got knocked out of the cup at Forest, Ferguson would have been out, and all the bookies were saying Ferguson will be out, you know, Ferguson's going to get an OBE out by Easter and all that.
Ferguson's trial was live on TV. He survived.
Hughes, he's got a lot of room. And here's Robbins. And did it get the deflection? Was it Robbins or Pierce?
Manchester United in the 1990s started snowballing from that day in January 1990 when Mark Robbins scored that goal, because we went on to win the FA Cup that year. And then, you know, his buy started to come good and we won the European Cup Winners' Cup, then we won the league and the FA Cup. And who knows what would have happened if it wouldn't have beaten Forest that day.
Wednesday night, 7:30. Coronation Street has just started. So has the Lancashire Youth Cup semi-final. Manchester United's youngsters are playing Tranmere Rovers. Alex Ferguson's success has always been based around young players.
You've been responsible for their upbringing, you've been responsible for their character building, you've been responsible for their development as human beings. And that work you put in is repaid in the loyalty the player gives you back. It's almost family then.
It's unbelievable, I tell you. It just had to happen, didn't it?
Anyone getting into football as a manager, you have to work hard, it's a commitment. I mean, I go to games and I go to some godforsaken places, you know, hoping to see something. You know the workers, they're all out there going to games every week.
A queen for memory.
After extra time, Tranmere are the unexpected winners.
What do you think you would say to them now, just to try and pick them up a little bit? What would you?
No, I wouldn't say anything. No, because really, it's an examination of them. Yeah, anyway, there's a lot. Some may not make it, you know, and I think that it gives you a guideline about the progress they're making. And that's important.
That's great. Thanks a lot, Alex.
Oh, yeah. Cheers.
Right. See you today. Cheers, mate.
You know he talks so hip, man, you twist him a melon, man.
In the 90s, Manchester became the dance capital of the world. Now it had a team to match. United won the FA Cup and the European Cup Winners' Cup. There were no banners calling for Ferguson's head now. Stand out your fire, can change your desire. Don't you know he can make you forget your man? Stand out your fire, can change your desire. Don't you know he can make you forget you're the man?
Manchester was just taking off, and it was Manchester at the time. It was something that just sort of built up and built up, and we sort of met at the top, and me and Giggsy and people like that, and the younger players were being turned into pop stars by pop magazines and teeny magazines.
So 1 minute, you know, you could walk down the street and not be noticed, and the next minute people are stopping you asking for your autograph. It was strange at first, but you know, you enjoy every minute of it.
Football was the new rock and roll. Giggs and Sharp were its teenage superstars. Good-looking and fashionable, the perfect package. Ferguson fought hard to keep the media at bay and the lads' feet on the ground.
I'd got myself a Jeep. I'd got a big dog, I'd got a set of drums, I'd got the house, I'd got sort of everything, all the little playthings and the toys. And he came round after someone had told him at some function he'd been to. They'd seen me and Giggsy in Blackpool on such and such a night. We're on the Pleasure Beach, now about eight of us. He says, no, it couldn't have been Blackpool. I sent him home. He said, I sent him home and told him to go to bed. They couldn't. No, he said, look, we've got their autographs, the kids got their autographs. Right, that's it. Got up from the function in his dicky bow, came round to my house, banged on the door, forced his way in, kicked everyone out that was in the house, and says, like, sat me down, got his face right there, and was like, right, you're getting rid of your dog, your house, your car, and what are they, them drums, get rid of them as well. It was like, get rid of the lot, you're back in digs again. So that was it, back in digs, house sold, girlfriend back to Birmingham. That was the last I seen her, I think.
I went up to Brian Robson and said, do you think I should ask for a club car? You know, I'm a regular now, I play 20, 25 games. Do you think I should go and ask for a club car? He says, well, yeah, I don't see why not. So I asked Steve Bruce, he says, yeah.
We all said, yeah, Giggsy, sure, your club car. Of course you are, you've played 15 times in the first team, you're one of us now. Come on, ask him, on you go.
So I went up, expecting, you know, I said, oh, yeah, no problem. So I went, you know, Gaffer, I've played most of the season. Any chance of a club car? And he just looked up at me and went, club car, you're not even getting a club bike, now get out now. And I walked out and all the players were outside just laughing at me, and they knew what he was going to say.
It's virtually impossible to determine who surprised the most by the events of the last 24 hours. Alex Ferguson, Cantona by the speed of it all, or the Leeds fans who afforded him cult hero status with the chant, "Ooh ah Cantona."
Ooh ah Cantona. They won't sing it here. Definitely not.
Alex Ferguson never intended to buy Eric Cantona. A chance phone call led to his arrival. Cantona was troubled. Ferguson took a chance.
And here is Cantona, and that's three!
The way Alex handled him was very important, because had Alex not handled him properly, he would probably have not been here as long as he stayed, and we wouldn't have been as successful.
Cantona was the key to everything that followed. In 1993, United raced towards their first championship in 26 years.
Alex Ferguson, of course, is a great manager. He knows exactly what the players need in different kind of moments. Sometimes he needs to be calm, because the player needs confidence, and he knows when he has to scream to them. You know, scream, yeah? Yep. And I think it's what it makes the difference between him and the other managers.
Cantona, Ince, going the long way around, and Cantona!
The year before, United had thrown away the title to Leeds. Now they stuttered again. Sheffield Wednesday led 1-0 at Old Trafford, with a few minutes to go.
Mr. and Bruce in the queue again. Bruce scores! And the manager saving every vital second. Bruce won.
Well, when you see Alex Ferguson and Brian Kidd jumping and dancing around like that, when you see them afterwards, I think that mirrored everybody.
You just couldn't believe it. I just remember sprinting over to the far corner and everyone just jumping on each other, and it was just brilliant.
Oldham were playing Aston Villa, who were the only other team that could stop us winning it. Televised match on the Sunday. About seven or eight of us, and the kids were there and the wives were there, taking a passing interest. I think we all believed that Villa would win, but we had champagne on the television there in a nice bucket, and it was ready just in case. But with minutes to go, Oldham scored.
Puts it in for Oldham and Plymouth. Another twist on the plot of the tournament.
We erupted. We just danced around the room, and then just finally, after about 92 minutes, the whistle blew.
Champion!
I honestly can't remember a great deal about it, because I left the room then like a screaming banshee through my sister's French windows. I pulled the curtains that were red and white and just draped them around my shoulders and went tearing off down the road like a madman.
The party's gone on and on and on, and I remember Alex ringing me about half 11 and says, just make sure I have a couple of glasses, you know, because we've still got an important game tomorrow. Like this on the phone, you know, oh yeah, try to keep the noise down, everybody's unbelievable time.
Alex Ferguson has won four Premiership titles with Manchester United, but he won't win it this year. Arsenal will be champions if they beat Everton today. United play tomorrow.
He's putting a bet on Fergie's horse. His team's out to go by.
No.
There's your money down the drain.
No. There's eight horses in the race, you get to play first and second. He's not been out in the first two for 6 years, has he? And they're a failure now because they've come second. You know, they're a disaster because they've been second. When you think about it, how many teams in the Premier League would like that?
I think they're sick. I mean, obviously that's the reaction you want.
Yeah.
It's not affected their training.
No. They've been
all right that way.
Well, I think we should certainly have a look.
I don't think that there's any pressure on them now. I think they realise that. They're just hoping that Arsenal's
I know we've only a couple of games to go, but we want to get as many points as we can. I mean, that's the feeling, what the lads are.
That's what I've just seen now. We'll
see what happens, because it's still not over yet.
Points.
Still not over yet.
Exactly, it's not over yet. All right.
Yeah,
I've got Mickey Walsh. Have you met Mickey Walsh? You seen Mickey Walsh in here?
Which Mickey Walsh?
Yeah, we put him in Blackpool, in Porto.
Yeah.
He's in here with his photographs.
Oh, I see. Yeah,
he's
looking
at that. That's brilliant.
Yeah.
All right.
He's good
around,
don't we make you look handsome? Don't we? Eh?
So we'll work after that, right?
Right, okay.
I think for my part, I should have the bigger squad. I should have bought in. And then I hold my hands up there. That was a killer for us. Worst half team. You know, and you think with my experience, we'd have been well prepared for that type of thing.
I've got to blame Ferguson, I'm afraid. He's had money there, like, to spend. He's had injuries and never replaced players. And all. We got away with it in the early part of the season, like with Roy Keane. He's a big, big loss. He was a big, big loss. We've never replaced him.
You've got to concentrate. We took our eye off the ball, and I think we're paying for it now.
In the pub, United supporters pray that Arsenal lose at home to struggling Everton. They won't. The only cheers in Manchester come from City fans.
I didn't bother with the Arsenal game. I watched the City game. I was watching the Super, and it flashed up Arsenal win. Everton nil after, was it 5 minutes, I think, or something like that. Anyway, it didn't really bother me. I wasn't expecting them to lose. But when I saw 1-0, I said, well,
after 5 minutes, you're not going to be worrying about the rest of the day, are you? So my day went in quite quick, actually. My wife thinks I'm too greedy, you know. Maybe I've been expecting to win the league again, and she makes a good point. She says, you can't win it every year.
I think I bring him back to earth, you know, sort of a... I mean, he realises when he comes home that there's more things in the world, you know, than football. You know, you've got to remind him that, you know.
Which is true, but you try to tell your supporters and maybe your directors or your players that it doesn't go down, because, particularly supporters, because their whole life is about going into work on Monday being proud of their team. So his whole life is revolving around our fortunes, you know what I mean? So they wouldn't understand Cathy's point, but I know what she means. I think she's right in a way that, you know, you can't win it, but your intention is to win it every year, you know?
Last home game of the season. Another full house. Nothing to play for but pride.
Oh, best, Dickie. Good luck, son.
Right. The dressing room is painful. A mixture of disappointment and defiance.
Oh, best, Andy. Good luck, son. Oh, best, Squiggy. Oh, best, son. Oh, best, son. Good luck.
It's true, I think some people either want to go to Blackpool for holidays, or they want to go to Spain, or they want to go to the moon. And you do need luck, you know. I've had pieces of luck, you know, in my life.
With you, sometimes wonder where the enthusiasm, where the motivation, where the level of intensity comes from within him, because it's there every game, and while that's there in him, it's always there in the players, in that you can see on the pitch, you know you've got to do well and you've got to perform.
What are you going to ask me?
I was going to say, great performance. Was
right.
It, there's no way you're lying down, is there, in accepting yesterday's results in the future? If you say what they said then,
that's all, just stick with that.
He'd been obsessed with the game. He's obsessed with winning. And it might be alright, but he's one of the lucky ones. Because if you're obsessed with something and you don't succeed, you become a lunatic. There's hundreds of them going about there who have been obsessed with winning, who don't do it, and they end up lunatics. But he's alright. He's been successful, so it stopped him from becoming a real lunatic.
Alex is a born manager, if there is such a thing as a born manager. You know, I mean, he will say that he was a player, you know, who became a manager. But manager was his destiny, to be a manager. That was what he was good at.
He's the best manager I had. And he's the one I respected the most. And still respect him, and I will be all my life. And I wish him the best and to win everything, more things.